Welcome to freedomlovin.com, where we focus on building freedom in an unfree world. Through personal development, location independence, and passive income strategies. Now here's your host, Kevin Koskela.
Welcome to Freedom Love, and this is Kevin, and this is episode number 84. Thanks for listening today. In just a minute, I have an interview coming up with Lewis Smith of itinerantdev.com. He is a listener of the show and is also a digital nomad, world traveler, and he's going to talk a little bit about travel and the digital nomadic lifestyle and ayahuasca, the drug that is getting pretty popular these days, and it's a really interesting chat, so stay tuned for that. And just a few things before we get to that interview. In case you missed the last couple shows, I've announced that we have a Facebook group that I formed a few weeks back, and it is the Freedom Lovin' Quest group. So if you want to join that, you can do so by going to Facebook and searching for Freedom Lovin' Quest and then just request to be added, or just friend me on Facebook and then I will add you to the group. It would be great to have you in the group, so check that out if you get a chance. There's a lot of chat in there about different ways to build freedom, and so a lot of different types of topics come up. You may be interested in it, so check that out when you get a chance. And also, I mentioned that I offer the New Mexico LLC on freedomlovin.com. The page was down. It is back up. So you can find out more. If you have any kind of business online and you're looking to get incorporated or to form an LLC of some sort, you can use a New Mexico LLC and do business invisibly or anonymously. And there's so many benefits that go along with that. And it's the best thing that I found out there. That's why I am offering it on the site now, because it ties directly into the freedom lifestyle. So if you are interested in it, go to freedomlovin.com/LLC. And you can find out more information there. And again, the benefits are that you do not have to put your name on the company documents. And there is no annual fee for the LLC like there is in so many other states. And there's no paperwork required to yearly. So you don't have to do the meeting notes or any of that stuff that so many other states require. And you also can do this as a, if you're not in the U.S., you can actually have a New Mexico LLC. So it's not just an American thing. So check that out. It's freedomlovin.com/LLC. And feedback. I got some feedback that the audio quality in the last two shows has not been up to par, and I apologize for that. I'm not sure what exactly happened, but I think it's the change that they made. I use a software called Audacity to record, and they made some sort of change to it, and the settings that I used to be able to set easily were no longer there. So I kind of just was guessing as to my audio settings, and I think I may have mistakenly put the wrong ones in. And so hopefully this one sounds a little bit better, but I'm going to, just for in the safety sake, I'm going to go get a new microphone, because I've been operating with this really cheap microphone for a while and it's probably at time to upgrade anyway. So, but hopefully this time around it sounds a little bit better. I listened to it myself. I listened to like a sample just now of my own voice and didn't sound bad, but I can hear definitely the last two shows there was some issue. And I don't know exactly what it was, but it sounded a little bit crackly. And at the end, the volume changes at the end where it gets really loud. So sorry about that. I didn't even notice it when I was listening to the show last week. But thanks, Michael, for pointing that out. So I appreciate that. Any feedback is great. And I want to just improve things as much as possible. So I will work on this and keep getting better. So in the next few weeks, you should start to hear some better sound coming from the Freedom Lovin' Podcast. I'm also in a new place that doesn't have much on the walls, so I have a little bit of an echo going on in the room that I'm recording, so that could be part of it too. But anyway, the last thing I want to mention is that we installed a Bitcoin tipping widget on the blog. So all of these podcasts and blogs, you can now tip with Bitcoin. And so it's set up for 0.01 Bitcoin that you just, it's really easy to do. So if you have a Bitcoin wallet, you can easily tip on these pages, which I'd really appreciate. I'd love to get a Bitcoin. I think I've gotten like 2, maybe 3 donations in Bitcoin, which is really awesome. But if you liked a particular episode and you want to just kind of show your support, and you just, I mean, even if it's like what they call a Satoshi, which is like a fraction of a fraction of a fraction of one Bitcoin. So it's like, you know, less than probably 5 cents. So, I mean, anything is just kind of like, I would be really grateful for if anyone has Bitcoin out there and wants to show support that way. That would be really cool to see, but no pressure. But I'd love to also, if you are going to do that, please send me a note with some feedback, because like the people that did donate Bitcoins, I don't know who they are, and I'd love to know. That's the one downside of Bitcoin, I think, is that with PayPal, you can see who it came from right away. And with Bitcoin, it's all anonymous. So I just see it came from an address. And so it's nice to get that, but it'd also be nice to get just a little note saying, hey, this is, you know, I'm listening. This is who I am. This is where I'm from. So anyway, that's about it. This is a really interesting interview coming up with Lewis Smith. I hope you enjoy it. Go out there and build some freedom. And thanks again for listening, and we'll talk to you soon. Cool. Well, I am really excited to have digital nomad Lewis Smith from the UK on the show today. And Lewis travels around the world with his wife while creating iPhone apps and websites. And his site is itinerantdev.com. I hope I said that right.
Yeah, you did.
Great, Lewis. Welcome to Freedom Lovin'.
Thank you. It's great to be here.
Yeah, absolutely. Your story is really interesting, and so I'm really glad that you contacted me and we're talking right now. So how did you grow up? Like, what kind of a childhood did you have, and what led you to pursuing this kind of a lifestyle of permanent travel?
I went to a Catholic school when I was a teenager, but it was quite unusual because it was a very kind of nonconformist Catholic school. And so they had a real emphasis on being a rounded person and not on grades. It was actually really liberal, and like we'd call the teachers by their first names and things like that. And it was just always felt kind of like anything was an option. Nothing was too silly or crazy. And so that was kind of a big part of it.
I got to interrupt you right there, because I had a very similar experience in high school. I went to a Catholic school that sounded, I mean, not quite as casual, but we were required to take a class called Major Religions of the World, which taught us about all these other religions. I don't know if
Yeah, we definitely covered other religions, and we didn't have a uniform at all. Yeah. It's kind of changed quite a bit since I left, sadly, but yeah, we didn't have a uniform. Everything was very laid back, and it was really nice, and we just felt like we were growing up, I guess, thinking about it now. And so, yeah, that was really nice. But kind of after that, I didn't do a gap year, which a lot of people do, where between like either before university or after university, they take a year off and do their trip around the world and all that kind of stuff. And we never really, or I never did that. And I just plowed straight into a career and that. And so I always kind of had that. That was a part of it as well, is that actually I never really did much travel when I was a kid. And I didn't leave Europe until, well, apart from America. So I had a few days in the States, but didn't really leave Europe until I was in my 30s. But it was always kind of there, that desire. And it kind of just got built up really strong, rather than just being kind of dissipating a little bit at a time, I guess.
Yeah, so it was more like your curiosity was kind of getting to you and you wanted to get out there?
Yeah, exactly. So, I mean, in terms of what more specifically, what led to the nomadic part of it, when me and Jane got married, or after we got married, we went on honeymoon to Thailand, and we had 3 weeks just traveling around Thailand. And we went to Chiang Mai in particular. Is obviously like this big famous digital nomad hotspot. But when we were there, we weren't aware of that at all. But we were just wandering around thinking, man, this town is just be such a nice place to live. And we spent these 3 days just thinking, I wonder if you know, what it would be like to live here. Something like living in Thailand, we never thought about at all beforehand. But once we were there, we felt like it was a really good fit for us. And so when we got back to the UK, this thought just, it didn't go away. And we actually quit our jobs and set off traveling 6 months after that. Yeah, after the honeymoon. That was the biggest thing, I think.
So after your honeymoon, you went back to the UK and then just planned this 6 month
getaway? Yeah, exactly. So there was actually a friend of ours who'd been working on, he'd been building up his app business, and he had done a few trips, and he was starting to make more money from his apps than he was in his day job. And so he really wanted to kind of do this thing as well. And so the three of us would go to the pub and talk and have a few, you know, beers. We just kept talking about this and talking about this. And after about 3 months, I think we were like, we're still talking about this. We're going to do it. And I had to give 3 months' notice at work. And so we all went in, the three of us, on the same day and gave our notice at the same time, so that just so that none of us could kind of chicken out or whatever. We all were all confident that we were going to do it. And so, yeah, we did it really quick and we started saving, you know, really quickly. The other thing I should say was actually the 4-hour work week was a kind of quite a big factor in that as well.
Yeah.
And so we'd read before we got married, I wanted to lose a bit of weight to look good in the old tux for the wedding. And I read The 4-Hour Body. Jen was like, you should read this. This will help you with losing the weight. And it obviously did. And I was really pleased with that. And so afterwards, after we got back from the honeymoon, we were reading his other book. And that, I think now a lot of the advice in there is basically completely useless or completely irrelevant. But in terms of the stories or just that kind of, you feel so excited when you read it. And so between that and the fact that we wanted to do it anyway, it all kind of came together and we made it happen very quickly. So yeah, it was good. It was an exciting time.
That's awesome. And so you guys are both on board with all this. I mean, it wasn't like a time where one of you was kind of like, I don't know, I think this is a little bit too much. Or...
No, not at all. And so we talked before about emigrating to Australia. We actually kind of got quite far into doing that. It was always kind of somewhere in the background that we wanted to do something different. And then this, the kind of Thailand was a catalyst for it. But we're very lucky that we both have very similar, on the kind of big picture stuff, we have very similar attitudes. And we just, you know, we like to travel at the same pace and do the same kind of things. And like everything like that works out very well. We're very lucky.
That's awesome. That's awesome. So then you started in Thailand. Is that where you went back to, or did you start somewhere else?
Yeah, no, so we went back to Thailand. So originally we were going to do like a round the world backpacking trip. We bought round the world flights. And yeah, so we went back to Thailand and we traveled around Southeast Asia for a bit. We were trying to do like a bit of work here and there, but really it was a holiday. Yeah, that's where we started, was back in Thailand and Southeast Asia. And they're kind of, it's very cheap, it's very easy, and you can see a lot of stuff. It's so different to the West. And so it feels very mind expanding, maybe. Like, it's just a very different perspective, I think.
Yeah, I totally agree. So you spent most of your time in Chiang Mai then, or were you just kind of going around?
In that initial trip, we went to the islands in the south of Thailand, and so we kind of toured around there, and then we went to Chiang Mai for a bit, and then we went to Laos and Cambodia, and then me and Jen went to Burma. Like, the friend who we were traveling with broke his arm. He came off a scooter, and he realized he'd broken his arm, and he went home for 6 weeks. And so me and Jen holed up in Chiang Mai, and then we were like, right, we're going to go to Burma and just go around there. So we had 3 weeks in Burma, which was really interesting.
Wow, that's crazy. And that was, what year was that?
That was like 3 years ago, so okay. 2012.
They still were pretty, because it's only been the last, what, maybe 2 years ago that they kind of opened up a little bit to tourism?
It was, when we were there, that it was open. So it changed from being that you absolutely shouldn't go there, like, because the government is too bad, to now you should go there, but, you know, it's going to be, you're going to miss a lot of things that you're used to. And so I don't know what it's like now, but when we were there, there was no ATMs that you could use, for example. So that was the biggest thing.
Yeah.
So, and you have to take like super fresh, like dollar bills, and that's what you're going to spend. And so you really, you have to take all your money, or we had to take all our money with us. Which is something that we just like to use an ATM and just carry as little cash as possible. But there, yeah, we were carrying our whole money, and you have to really budget when you literally have, you're going to run out. And I think in the end we changed some dollars into the local currency. But it's a beautiful country. I definitely recommend it. Like, there's a lot of things which are kind of less touched by Western influence because it's been so isolated. So you can see, like, all the men wear these kind of skirt type things, and there's just a lot of things that are just different, and they've kept their ways. And so there's no internet, that's the other big thing. And so, or when we were there, there was, I think we went to one place where there was internet, and everywhere else there's nothing. And to start with, that's really jarring, and you're kind of like, and you know, it feels like some part of your anatomy has been removed.
Then
After a while, it's as long as you're not trying to work, obviously, then it becomes quite nice and you just talk to other people or you look at the books. Or and often for booking our next place, we would just go down to the hotel and ask them, you know, where do you recommend we're going here? Where do you recommend to stay? And can you call ahead for us? And that's actually really nice. Like, yeah. It's kind of, yeah. And not thinking like, oh, what does TripAdvisor say? And what does so-and-so say? And you kind of get into this, like, I'm sure there's a word for it. I guess it's FOMO or, you know, yeah, something like that, where you just like you have the best experience and actually you just kind of relax into it and you go with what people say. And if it's not perfect, then it doesn't really matter. You're still having a great time.
Yeah, it's when you were saying that they have no internet, it reminded me of there's a South Park episode. I don't know if you've seen it, but the town, the internet goes down and everybody just starts freaking out and they actually come out of their houses. And they're trying to find internet and they have to go travel to California.
Yeah, but I haven't seen it, but yeah, it sounds right. But
yeah.
So, but if you don't have to work, it is really nice. And especially because you can kind of think, well, I'm not going to have internet, but then you still kind of do. That's really a holiday, actually, is when you've got no email for 2 or 3 weeks, you're really disconnected.
That sounds really amazing, because I'm one that just, I really can't stand email and I get too much of it and I don't even like to do it. And I like that idea of a break, and I think that's a good way to do it, is to go see somewhere that doesn't even have email doesn't even have internet, I mean, and you're kind of forced to. But were you trying to work at that time, or was it just that was part of the thing as you were kind of getting away from it?
In Burma, no, we weren't trying to work at all. And so before that, around there, we were trying to do some work. But yeah, not in Burma. We were just like, because we knew the internet wasn't going to be good. And so we were just like, we're just not going to bother. And in fact, I did wind up doing a few bits of work, like just flying stuff. We did this really long boat ride that was like 6 hours or something. And I went and sat and did some coding for a while then. But that was almost just to, you know, fun to pass the time. And so, yeah, we didn't really do any work in Burma. And I wouldn't recommend trying to. It might be better now, I don't know. It's supposed to be getting better all the time, but certainly not improving at the pace that the Burmese would like. So
yeah,
there you go.
So then when you left there, was it like when you finally got to your email again and got to internet, was it like kind of a, I don't know, did you miss anything, or was it kind of a relief? Or
you mean did we miss, like, did anything, did the like the world end while we were
exactly
away? Like, no, not that I remember. So I'd put like an out of office message on my Gmail so that anyone who did email me would know that I was going away. And I didn't have any clients or anything at that point. So there was nothing really catastrophic waiting to happen. So for me, it was fine. It would probably be harder now because I have a few freelance clients and things. But I think if I, you know, if I gave them plenty of warning and things, I think it wouldn't be a problem at all. Yeah, no, the world definitely keeps on spinning and it's all still there when you get back. And once you kind of detox from it after a few days or a week or whatever, you really get into it and it's nice. And it's almost the other way. You kind of realize how much you chained to your phone or whatever.
Right. Yeah. So, yeah, I'm really curious about Burma. I never made it there. I visited Cambodia one time and Laos another time. And I found that even though Thailand is pretty friendly, like, I found that people in general in those countries were way more friendly and just were so warm and welcoming. Is that kind of the same way in Burma?
Absolutely, yeah. People, the Burmese are super friendly. And I made a list, like, it was a few years ago now, but at the time I made a list of like something every day, that something that I could remember that was really nice that people had done just to help us out. And so, like, a few examples: if we asked for directions to a place for someone and they didn't have enough English to tell us, there was more than one occasion where they would just take us to where we wanted to go. And so it wouldn't be like miles and miles or anything, but they would get up from out of their house and come and show us where it was that we needed to be. And so that's a really nice example of just how out of the way friendly people would be. And yeah, there's definitely a real warmth to the people, and kind of they really want to hear, like, about your life and life outside of Burma. And they want to tell you about what life inside Burma is like. And I don't know, it's kind of similar but different to the rest of that part of the world, just because it has been isolated and because they had like a British colonial past and things like that. They've got a lot of very different influences to, I mean, all of that part of the world has different things. Like Vietnam, they obviously have this big war legacy, and Laos as well. And Cambodia's got their own troubles that they had. And so, yeah, it's certainly different, and it feels very safe. Like, I think it must be the poorest place that we went to. And not only the poorest place, but things are expensive as well. Like, a mobile phone would be I don't know. Also, to buy a SIM card was £50, I think it was, or it was just something where you just didn't even consider it. And so just basic stuff like that is very expensive. Nobody has a mobile phone. Nobody has, I don't know, anything that you can think of as just that you take for granted, or a lot of it people don't have there.
Yeah.
The same as in Thailand and places like that. You never feel like your stuff is going to disappear or people are going to take your stuff or anything like that. And so it's very safe. Yeah. I definitely recommend it. I definitely recommend it. Even if there is some internet there now or whatever, like, it's still going to be very different and a beautiful experience, I think.
Right, right. Because even, I don't know if you guys made it to Bali, but the internet, when I was there, which was about 3 years ago, two or 3 years ago, it was pretty much almost non-existent in most places. And, right. And unless you knew where to go, it was tough to be able to say, okay, I'm going to work for 3 hours today, because you just didn't know, right, you know, if it was going to be up or down. But
yeah, no, we haven't made it to Bali. To be honest, it always sounds beautiful, and then we start talking about the internet, and then that's when we get put off. So maybe we should actually go for a holiday, like I was just saying, and just take a few weeks off and just go around and not work and just go and enjoy the scenery and the food and everything.
Yeah, I think that's probably the best way to go. I mean, I've been told that it's gotten better since then, and it works in certain places. It's pretty good. But yeah, because then even if you do get internet, it's probably going to be slower than where you're used to, and that gets frustrating. So yeah, why not just take the time to check out for a little bit?
Yeah, sure.
So yeah, cool. So then after Southeast Asia, where did you guys head?
Yeah, we were in Southeast Asia, and then we went home for a bit. We had a family bereavement, and so we went back to the UK for a few months, and then we set off to go back to Thailand. So at this point, we'd had this round-the-world trip ticket or flights, and we still wanted to use those flights. So we'd got as far as Asia, but we still had flights, kind of the rest of the loop around the world from the UK. But we didn't want to go straight back to Thailand, and so we went to Turkey and Israel and Jordan and kind of made our way eastwards like that. And then we went from Jordan back to, I think it was from Jordan, we went back to Thailand. And that was a really great time as well. Like, Turkey is just fantastic country, I think. And Istanbul is just a really magical city.
Yeah.
The food there is just incredible. Like, for me, is, I don't know whether I can say for me as a Brit, but just for me, definitely, it's my favorite food in the world. Like, it's, everything is fresh, and it's spiced, but it's not too spicy. And like, they make this amazing bread. Like, if you have bread in Turkey, it's probably been made in the last hour, like almost every time.
Yeah.
And then just the buildings and stuff in the main tourist area, those buildings, you just feel like you've walked into a Disney film. And then the wider city is nice, and it's modern, and you know, you've got all your conveniences and cafes and everything, and there's good public transport, and you can go really far out. We were there for a month, and we just stayed in Airbnbs in a different neighborhood each week, kind of getting further and further away from the tourist area. And everywhere is really nice. And there was a bit where we were kind of getting the boat to work every morning. I was working in a co-working space. Mm-hmm. I was doing a really stressful project, and I wanted to put this stressful project into an office and not into my house, or, you know, and cafes that was too noisy for phone calls and stuff. And so, but we were getting the ferry every day across from the Asian side to the European side. And there was one day there was a dolphin that we saw, like, just on the ferry. We saw a dolphin on the way to work, and stuff like that is just really nice. And we really felt like we lived there, because we were just doing commuter type stuff, and it's a nice city to live in.
What was the city? Which city was that?
Istanbul.
Oh, that was Istanbul. Okay.
Yeah. And so I highly recommend Istanbul.
Yeah, it sounds amazing. I was really hoping to get there this past summer, travel around Eastern Europe a little bit, and it just didn't work out in the plans, but it's on like near the top of the list. And I think the only thing that is with Turkey, and this is probably just because I listened to the media a little bit too much, but it sounds like it might be a little bit dangerous if you go too far south.
Yeah, I haven't been following it that much. So after we were there, it was like a week or 2 weeks after was when they had the big protests. But we had friends who were there during the protests, and they thought it was fine. They went and were like tourists and took photos of all this stuff going on. And then I think there are areas where they have troubles, and, you know, it's probably not a good idea to go.
Right.
But Turkey is a huge country, you know. It's like, I don't know, 5 hours to fly from one side to the other. Like, it's a big country. And if you're in Istanbul, you're going to be a long way away from where you are. Certainly for the UK, there's you can. There's a website called the FCO, which is the Foreign Commonwealth Office, and they issue travel advice. And I'm sure there's a US equivalent.
Yeah.
And that tends to be very balanced. And they will just, and when there's something like a terrorist attack, it will either be like, you shouldn't go to this area. And if they say that, then you just don't go. But generally, like, it will be, there was this attack, follow, you know, look at the local news, if follow the, you know, local advice and things like that. And so I think it's not that difficult to be informed and to trust. I would trust the FCO over what the newspaper are telling me, you know, because their only interest is keeping their citizens safe, and they don't need to sell the news or anything.
Yeah, it's funny that you say that, because when I was traveling to Southeast Asia, my dad sent me some reports from the same, I don't know what it's called, but it's the US equivalent of what you're mentioning. And the first one was Bali was on the list. Like, never go to Bali. It's,
oh, really?
It's like terrorism there. And it's like, you know, yeah, there's like, it's a hotbed and all this stuff. And
all of Bali, though? Because yeah, there was one area where there's a lot of Aussie tourists, and that sometimes gets targeted.
Kuta. Yeah, what it is, and then I read, and then he sent me another one that was Thailand. Same thing. Like, don't go to Thailand. There's a lot of problems there. But what it is the government has no incentive to not give you these dire warnings, because if something happens, then they can say, "Well, we told you that things are bad." But if 20 years go by and nothing happens, they don't lose anything.
Well, I would recommend checking out the UK one then, because that feels so. For Thailand, I know in the south of Thailand, right on the border, they have a lot of troubles. But the rest of Thailand. But there's been occasional problems in Bangkok, and I get those emails. The emails say, you know, there was a terrorist attack. Just be aware that that's there. And if you see something that smells like trouble, then don't trust your instincts and get out of there. But generally, Bangkok is safe, and, you know, you shouldn't not go there. And so, yeah, I think it's fco.gov.uk, and you can go on there and you can just, they've got all of the countries in the world, and you can just give your email address and then tick the ones you're interested in. They send you emails with updates to the website, basically. And in my experience, it's been very balanced. And it seems to me like they want you to go places, and they will only tell you not to go there. And it will be by region as well. It won't be like, don't go to Thailand. It will be, don't go to this area.
Right.
Yeah. So I recommend that. And it is balanced and fair, I think.
Cool. You guys have been in a lot of countries at this point. Where would you love to go back? And is there any place that you would just never go back to?
Yeah, so I talked about Turkey already. I think that's really high up there for places I'd like to go back to. I think when we talk about our kind of favorite place, I think it's New Zealand. It's just so beautiful in New Zealand. And for us, as well as, because the English is obviously the first language there, the main language, and there's a lot of kind of British history. It feels kind of like, it really feels like the UK, only with all the, anything that you don't like about the UK, they don't have in New Zealand, is kind of how it felt to us.
Yeah.
And so they have like tea and stuff that makes us feel really comfortable and at home. But then they've got like so little population. The population is so low. And so everybody is so chilled out, and they're really far from everywhere, and they really don't care. They feel very happy with that they're just like a little country that, you know, does some sheep farming or whatever. But they like that, and the people are just so friendly. And you always hear stories of people like, just they'll be on the plane to Auckland, and the person next to them will be saying, "So, oh, where are you staying? Like, oh, don't, you know, it's not booked. Come and stay with me, or I'll give you a lift in," and stuff like that. And that kind of thing just happens all the time. And the scenery is just beautiful as well, especially in the South Island. You feel like you're in Lord of the Rings like the whole time, like really out in the country.
Yeah.
And it's a big thing to just, or the thing is to get a camper van and drive around. And there's lots of free or very cheap campsites. Yeah, it's spectacular, really. And so I think that's my favorite.
Nice. Yeah. Yeah, that's a great country. I think that the difficult thing, I was there for 2 weeks, and that wasn't nearly enough because of the terrain. It's just a little bit too hard to get around. There's no, like, you can't like take the train, or there's no really easy way to do it. But I think, yeah, doing a van, taking like a month and going around the whole country would be really fun.
Yeah, exactly. And it's really set up for that as well. There's lots of campsites, and that's just kind of what people do. So it's very easy, and it's very flexible as well. Like, we went there right in the high season, but we're kind of on shoulder season, and you don't have to book anything. And so if you feel tired of driving, you can just stop somewhere. Or if you're like, right, let's do a good day's drive, you don't have to worry about finding somewhere to sleep and stuff like that. It ticks a lot of boxes. It's very comfortable and very beautiful. And just the driving as well. Like, even the driving, is really nice. And so you drive around and you kind of get to the point where you're thinking there can't just be another beautiful, breathtaking thing. And then you go around the corner and bam, there it is. And it's really nice. Like, yeah, very beautiful. And yeah, I highly recommend it. And the fact that it's so far away is kind of part of its appeal. Like, so they do get tourists, but not in the same way as other places which are easier to get to.
Yeah.
So yeah, yeah, I recommend it for travel, definitely. For kind of digital nomad stuff, maybe less so. Like for me and be it having clients in the UK, it's very difficult having like the 12-hour, 13-hour time zone difference. That was difficult sometimes. Like there's not really any good time that's good for both people to talk. It's either you're talking at 9 o'clock at night or right. That was mostly when I was doing it. I was just taking calls like after 9 p.m. And then things like the internet is okay. The internet is fine. It's good, but there isn't as much of a kind of work cafe. They're around, but not as much.
Yeah.
And things like that. But I was working on campsites, you know, and the campsites would all have Wi-Fi and they'd have like a little communal area. And then there would be me just kind of huddled in the corner, like doing my few hours work to keep my project moving forward. So yeah, you can do that as well. But again, I would try and you can go to like, what we did was we went to Christchurch and I was just there for 2 weeks, just working solid, trying to get this project finished so we could go and do this travel. And we had a limited time as well. So if you went for longer, you could probably buy a van and just go really at your own pace. And then that would be a nice way to do it. And if you go for more than, we went for 6 weeks. And I think if we'd gone just for a few weeks longer, we could have justified the risk of buying a van. But as it was, because we had to sell it quickly and things like that. So if you had a long time, you could go and you could buy a van and sell a van and it'd be much cheaper than renting one. And there's a big market for that as well. But we kind of worked out if we did the maths and just for 6 weeks, we didn't think it was worth the risk, but for anything longer and we would have bought one.
Yeah, that sounds awesome. And now, are there any countries that or places in the world that you've been that you would just never go back to? Or possibly, did you ever feel like in danger anywhere?
Well, so I've got kind of two answers for that, I think. So in terms of places I wouldn't go back to, we like Cambodia overall, but Siem Reap in Cambodia, I found that I really didn't like. We got kind of mild scams a few times. It felt much more scammy than anywhere else in that part of the world that we've been. And it felt very, like the actual town, like Angkor Wat is obviously why everybody goes and that's really beautiful. But once you've seen that, I don't feel any need to go back and see it again. And I don't feel like I want to go back to Siem Reap again. I heard someone talking about it recently and saying it was a place to go, but that was definitely not my experience. Like it just felt kind of, it didn't feel dangerous, but it didn't feel nice. You know, it just felt like, you just felt like you were a bag of money walking around, you know, with all of it. And so,
I have a story I can relate to, or a couple of them. By the way, did you happen to fall for the powdered milk scam?
No, I didn't. Okay. Tell me about that.
So I didn't know this going in, but I went to an ATM in Siem Reap, and right as I turned to walk away, there was a woman standing there with a little baby, and she's asking me if I could buy her milk for her baby. And usually I don't really like give people money ever, because you just end up giving everybody money when you travel. But I just felt so bad. The baby was so cute, and I was like, okay, I'll go into the store with you and buy you something. And so I was just going to go get some regular milk. And I walked up to the refrigerator and she's like, no. Like, what? She's like, no, powdered. And she's pointing to the powdered milk. And she's looking at me like really angrily. And I'm like, no, because that's like three times as expensive. I'm like, I'm just going to get you regular milk and you can take it or leave it. And she looked really like upset at me. But I just ended up buying it and leaving. And then it turns out this is a scam that they run that has nothing to do with the baby. They get all this powdered milk and they give it to someone and they get paid for it. They get paid extra or something. And that was one. And then the other was, I kind of have the same feeling as you, is like the town itself wasn't really much. I was walking down the street and this kid walked up to me, little like maybe 8-year-old, 9-year-old. And he walked up and asked me for money. And I said, no. And he asked me about three more times, kind of following me. I said, no, no, no. And then eventually he just goes, fuck off.
No way.
I'm like, wow. That was insane. But
yeah. Yeah. That's not cool.
Yeah.
And then in terms of kind of dangerous places, like I've got kind of a funny story about that. Like, so we were in about about 3 weeks ago, we were in Mexico City, which is obviously, like, we were talking before we came on air about how Mexico has this really bad and dangerous reputation. And our experience from being in Mexico for 6 months was absolutely the opposite. We didn't really feel in danger anywhere. And you just feel very safe and very comfortable. And, you know, people are so friendly and everything else. And yeah, it feels very safe.
Yeah.
But we were in Mexico City, and there's this Slack channel and forum and everything called Hashtag Nomads, which you've probably heard of. And there was a guy on there, and he was like, me and some of my guys from my company are here for like an away day for a few days. Do you want to meet up? And so we were like, yeah, that sounds great. We'll do that. And we were talking about going for a beer. We were staying in the same neighborhood, and we arranged all this to go for a beer with him and so on. And then like an hour before we were going to meet up with him, he was like, oh, we've got this great business idea that we're working on, and we'd really like to show you it. Will you come to our apartment beforehand so we can talk about it? And when he said it, I was like, yeah, sure, we'll do that. And then on the way there, we were like, what is this? Why are we going to this guy's apartment to talk about his business idea? You know, we're just going to go into his place and so on. And we got a bit freaked out. And like, I sent my dad like an email with like a pin, like with my location, because we were like, but I didn't want him to worry. So I just sent him this pin with nothing else in the hope that this would be some vague clue if we never turned up, that this is where we've been. It was really stupid. And then obviously I'm here now, and they were really cool and everything was fine. But I think, yeah, ironically, the kind of most in danger I probably felt was just meeting some American guy in his place, because that's what he wanted to do. So yeah, don't meet people in their place, because it will make you feel weird.
Yeah. Like,
that would be my tip for that.
Yeah, that is strange. Yeah, so you felt Mexico was pretty safe overall. You never feel any kind of danger?
The place where we read that there was most danger, or we heard a few things, was Mexico City. But when we were there, we didn't feel anything. And we didn't go to there's like the main tourist area, and we only went there once. But then in the neighborhood where we were staying, which is called Condesa and Roma, that's kind of a big neighborhood. That's like a beautiful neighborhood. And
Yeah. It
just feels like it's kind of tough not to be dangerous, but not touristy enough to be, you know, attract people who are looking for that kind of thing. And so, yeah, we felt totally safe there. And then we went on the subway and stuff, which you're not supposed to do. And that felt really safe as well. And the subway is so cheap. It's like 5 pesos for like, you can go for one journey anywhere you want to go.
Yeah.
It's basically free. And then the rest of Mexico, we didn't even hear any problems. Like, so we heard there are bits of Mexico where, you know, it's the same thing as I was saying before, like south of Thailand, like really on the border, you just don't go there. And there are places like that in Mexico, but Mexico is a huge country, and there are places where they just have no problems. They're just beautiful, friendly people, and you can walk around at any time and just feel completely safe. And like in Playa del Carmen especially, like it's almost the opposite. Like we were speaking to a guy who lived there, and he had a Mexican wife and so on, and he was telling us like actually the kind of mafia run a lot of the businesses in Playa. Mm-hmm. And so if someone roughs up a tourist or robs a tourist, then it's probably not going to end well for them, because the mafia, actually everybody is on your side when you're in Playa in particular. Like, you know, like I felt like people wouldn't dare rob us. That was how I felt there. And then the other places, you just feel like people are too nice and that it's not going to be a thing. So, yeah. So we went to Guanajuato, Playa del Carmen, Mexico City, and Oaxaca. And in all of those places, we felt totally safe. And Mexico City was the only place we heard that, you know, there could be problems. But I think, as well, I kept meaning to look it up, but I think if you looked at the crime rates for Mexico City compared to New York or London or Barcelona or any major city, I can't believe it would be any different. I can't believe that Mexico City is more dangerous than any other, you know, major capital city. That, I mean, there are places in London where I would not go, and you just don't go to them. There's no reason to go to them. And I'm sure there are places in Mexico City like that. But I didn't go to them, and there was no problems at all.
Yeah, you just got to know where to go. Exactly. We took the subway there too. I didn't know you weren't supposed to, and I didn't see any problems at all. It seemed pretty.
Yeah.
Pretty normal.
Generally, so you weren't supposed to do it. I think if you were to and from the airport, if you had big bags, then maybe it could be a problem. I don't know. I think we could have done it, and it would have been fine. But I didn't regret not doing it either. So. Yeah, when we were on, it didn't feel like it was a problem. But I guess when it was very busy, it wouldn't have been great. Just for the practical side of carrying, because we don't have like carry-on. We've got a fair amount of, or relatively high amount of stuff. And so just getting on the really busy subway wouldn't have been great with the bags, but yeah, it didn't, to me, it didn't feel dangerous. Yeah, I liked it.
I think you're right. I had the same experience. Like in Mexico City, a lot of people told us that the violence that you hear about is really, it's all drug related. It's all the drug cartels. And they're like, as a tourist, you are super safe because those are the tourists are the last people that they want anything to happen to. So that it does feel safe in that way. Now I love talking about this stuff, but I wanted to ask you about your business. Like, how do you make all this possible? What is it exactly that you're doing when you're working on the road?
Okay, so it kind of splits into two areas which overlap. So as you said in the introduction, I make iOS apps and I do web development. And so for the iOS apps, and so both of those I do freelance as well as working on my own products. So I have a couple of iOS apps that I make, which I make some money from. And so there's one which is called World Time Widget, which shows, you know, when on your iPhone, if you swipe down from the top, you can have those kind of little widgets showing you bits of information. And I made a little app that just, you can just put in different world times in there. And so you can just really quickly see. So for me, it was when I thought of it when I was in New Zealand, and I was just really struggling to adjust, thinking like, what time is it in the UK right now? And I've got to arrange these calls or whatever. And so it was just right when that stuff was coming out. And so I just made this little thing that I could put the time at home and a few other countries in there and get to it really quickly. It was actually featured by Apple when it came out, which was really nice, and a few other kind of publications and stuff. And so that makes a little bit of money. And then
that's a free app, or there's advertisements on it?
It's a paid app, so it's like tier one. It's 79 cents, is it now? I forget what the 69p anyway in British money. But yeah, so it's paid. And I sometimes think about doing a free version or whatever, but I just haven't got around to it. And then another app that I have is called Progress. And that actually has another Tim Ferriss kind of tie-in. So I was mentioned before that before we got married, I was doing the 4-hour body. And part of his thing for that is that you shouldn't trust the scales. You should like get a tape measure and measure yourself, because the scales can just go up and down, or, you know, like it's just not as reliable. And so I was working on this little spreadsheet that had all these, you know, my different, like how big my stomach was and legs and so on. And in the end, I was wanting to learn iOS development. And so I just made myself this little app so that I could track that. And I put it out in the store. And that's been doing quite well and so on, and people use that, and you can take photos and things. And that's actually really, also wasn't intended to be, but it's actually really great for traveling as well, because like a tape measure you can get, and that can go in your bag no problem. Like, I wouldn't carry scales around with me to keep a track of my weight and that I'm staying healthy, but a tape measure fits really well. And so yeah, so that's kind of worked out pretty nice. Yeah, and I'm proud of that one. Cool. Well, I'm proud of them both, but you know, I'm proud of that it's kind of worked out, that it kind of fits in with the whole travel kind of thing. I kind of, that has a nice feeling for me.
Yeah,
and then I do freelance work as well. So the apps make like probably enough, like it's kind of borderline enough to live on, but we could live really cheaply in Chiang Mai on what we make, but kind of generally want to do more than that. And so I do freelance work as well. And so I do web development and app development for people. And so the last project that I did was making a booking system for a circus school. They have like an event once a year. And so I built this thing so that people could go on and choose which courses they wanted to do while they're on this weekend of learning trapeze and high jump and all this kind of cool stuff. So it's things like that. And so I do, yeah, that's the freelance kind of side of things.
That's awesome. You have a variety of things that you're working on. And so you're not relying on any one source of income, it sounds like.
Yeah, that's true. So ideally, I would like to do the apps. I would like, that would be my preference, would be to have that as my full source of income, and I kind of work on building those up. But it's kind of difficult when the freelance work comes up. It's kind of difficult to say no, because it's like, I'm going to earn more in a day than I'm going to earn in however long it is from the app sales. So, and when I don't work on the apps, I still get more or less the same amount of money. So it doesn't always, doing the work on the apps doesn't always actually increase the money that I make from them. Yeah, and the freelance work is nice. It's nice working for other people and doing different projects, and it's kind of, yeah, it's fun, and I kind of can flex my technical muscles, as it were, instead of just working on the same things all the time.
Right.
So, yeah, it's good. I like it.
So I really want to talk about this next topic is something that you brought up and really interests me is ayahuasca. And you've had either an experience or some experiences with ayahuasca. And actually, you're the second person that I've interviewed that has done it. But the first guy, he was about to do it. So he was like the next day he was going to do it. So I didn't get the actual result of what had happened. But I guess I have a lot of questions about this. So let's start with just what interested you about it, or what is it first? Because I think there's people listening that probably don't know what ayahuasca is. And then what was it that was interesting to you that led you wanting to try it?
Okay, so what it is it's originally from Peru, and it's kind of like an ancient kind of herbal tea that you take, and it's basically a psychedelic drug, kind of like LSD or magic mushrooms. It's kind of similar to those kind of things in the effects, but it's been used in kind of Peru as kind of, in Mexico they looked at making it illegal. They're like, this is a drug and it should be, we should ban it. But then they decided that it was kind of so culturally relevant in terms of it's kind of, it's part of a ceremony and people will do it to kind of for self-discovery and these kind of things, and they decided that they couldn't make it illegal and that it was too important culturally. And so like a lot of the ancient Mayans would take these kind of drugs and go on these kind of spiritual experiences to try and just learn more about themselves and be, it's just self-improvement basically. And in terms of having said all that, I hadn't heard of it at all, and we were in a co-working space in Playa del Carmen, and we were talking to this Australian guy, and he was saying he was going to do it, and we were talking to him about it, and it sounded really interesting, and he was kind of mentioning the names of all these scientists who had done, kind of proven that it was really good for expanding your mind and things like that. And I'm like a bit of a, being like an Apple developer, I'm kind of a bit of a Steve Jobs nut, and he's kind of got a quote where he talks about he took LSD, and he talks about, like, he said he thought that was what made him stand out from other companies at the time, was that like he'd taken LSD and it just was a profound impact on his life and things like that. And I'd always kind of wanted to do those kind of things, but I don't really move in those circles, and you're kind of buying drugs from drug dealers. That's like the worst place to buy drugs from, you know, and those guys aren't great. And so doing something like ayahuasca, part of what appealed to me was that it is legal and there's kind of this kind of ceremony around it, and you can get, you know, you can get reviews and you can get advice from people and things like that. And so, yeah. And so we really stumbled upon it, but it appealed to us straight away as just, yeah, an opportunity to do something that we wouldn't really be able to do in many other places. And yeah, we thought that we could really, really get something out of it.
Great. So how did it go? What was your experience like?
The experience was pretty interesting. So start off with saying that, to give a bit of a bigger picture, so you have to do a detox for like a week in the run up to it. And so you're not allowed to eat meat or coffee or alcohol, or you're not allowed to have sex. And you do this for a week, and and on the last day, you're not allowed even to eat really solid food. You can only have like smoothies and water and stuff like that. And so you do that in the run up, and then you go and you sit in this big group and you take the tea, and it builds up slowly. And so there was a band there actually at the place where we went. Band makes it sound like, you know, it was rock and roll, but it was like there was two acoustic guitars and a harp and a guy on bongos or something like that, and they just play this beautiful music with the harp especially. It's just like magical. And the experience is kind of intense. So you're very much into your own mind, you know, and you're kind of, it's hard to explain, but you feel like your mind is expanding. And so it's not so much that, well, so for me, I didn't like have hallucinations or visions, which is what a lot of people have, and including Jen and the Australian guy who we went with. But I didn't have that. But I did feel like my mind was expanding, and it wasn't like I had more knowledge, but it was like the knowledge that I had was more kind of available to me all at once, kind of like I could make connections or I could understand things that I already knew and kind of things like that. And so it's difficult to explain, and you don't really keep it. It's not like I now have all of that insight. So I can have the things that I remember, but that level of insight isn't like now available to me. That's definitely part of the drug. But it's also quite intense. Like you're very in your own head. You're there for like 6 hours. Just, you're not supposed to talk to anyone else or anything like that, and really be focused inwards on yourself. And you're supposed to have, I should say, you're supposed to have what's called an intention, which is where you kind of have an idea of what you want to get out of the session. And then this was part of the thing that appealed. And so I mentioned there that I do the freelance work and the app development work. And the app development work is kind of my dream, but as I mentioned, it doesn't really make enough money to live on. And so I kind of flip-flop between these two kind of things. And I was really like, maybe the ayahuasca can tell me, you know, which of these things I should be focusing on. And so I was kind of trying to think about that as part of it. Yeah, it was very intense and very beautiful and kind of emotional. Like a lot of people will just start crying and not even realize that they're crying and things like that. And yeah, it's very difficult to do justice to. I should probably send you like afterwards, and if you want to, you can dub it over or something. There's some of the music. You could buy CDs of the music, and it kind of gives you an idea. It gives me an idea because I put the two together of what the feeling was like. And so that's what it was like. And then in terms of whether I kind of, my intention was realized, as it were, like it was kind of yes and no. So like at the time, I didn't really have any feeling of like, oh, I'm going to do the apps and that's it. It's all set. Right. But the next day I felt just very calm and like, and I kind of realized that it's just not a problem. Like I'm just, it's a problem that I've made for myself. And like, there's a lot of stuff with people telling you to follow your dream and all this kind of stuff. And there's definitely merit to that. But on the other hand, it's just not worth making yourself unhappy about, you know, like I have enough money to be comfortable and happy. And I've got an interesting life and like a beautiful wife. And like, why am I worrying about whether my money comes from the app store or whether it comes from freelance work? It just, as long as I have enough, it doesn't matter where that, what the source of that money is. And so now I still think about those things and make decisions, but I don't get stressed. Like, am I doing the right thing? Am I doing the wrong thing?
Wow.
And now it even just sounds stupid to me to like, how could I have been that worked up about, you know, that thing? That was a really big thing that I got out of it. Another thing that I really got out of it was that this being in your own head, like that's intense. And it's, and you kind of realize that you don't spend, like if I just sit down, I'll probably get my phone out and look at Twitter or look at, you know, the RSS feeds. And so it's kind of like we were saying about the always connected thing. You're always connected and you never just sit and think or take, you know, some time. And so since doing that, I've taken up meditation and I do that every day. Mm-hmm. And it's nothing like fancy and whatever. It's, there's an iPhone app called Headspace.
Yep.
And you can just download these sessions to your phone, and there's different topics and things, and you just sit in silence for 20 minutes each day. And I find that it's really great. Like, just again, it's not like a huge mystical experience, but I just feel like it makes me a lot calmer and a lot kind of just happier with the life that I have, you know, and not feeling too much about things I don't have and or as much and things like that.
Yeah. That's so awesome. I mean, it sounds like you got quite a bit out of your experience, you know, like takeaways, you know, as opposed to just like, oh, it was a cool trip and, you know, then it's over.
Yeah. And so I wrote a blog post about it. And like at the end, I kind of said, like, it doesn't feel like, it feels like it was a change of course, like a small change of course. And so right now, it's not like I'm a different person, but I feel like in 10 years, this kind of change, I will be a different person in 10 years because of this, you know, one night that I spent doing with this drug. And so, yeah, I certainly got a lot from it. I have to say that, you know, it is a drug. And so if this is something that you're thinking about, you need to Google ayahuasca risks. You need to read the Wikipedia page. You definitely need to find a good shaman. Like, we were lucky because we had this person recommended to us by multiple people. But if it's the same, like with, you know, as I said before, you don't want to buy drugs from a drug dealer. You want to make sure that you're finding someone with a good reputation who's going to look after you, because there is definitely, with the intenseness of the experience, there's potential for it to, especially if you've got like issues with mental health or you've got things in your past that make you, you know, that challenging. Right. Like if you haven't got a really good environment, then, and this beautiful music and people there, they make a big deal of how they're going to help you. You know, if you've got a problem, just put your hand in the air and we'll come and help you. And that kind of environment is just the fact that they're there. It means you don't need it because you know that you're safe and you're cared for. But I can easily imagine that if you were not in a safe and protected environment, that it could go really the other way and you could wind up like, yeah, not having a good time.
Yeah.
And so, so I definitely recommend doing your research, understanding what it is better than I did. Like, I just went on the trust of this guy. That was a mistake. Luckily, my wife did a lot of research. And so we were kind of covered. Definitely do your research and definitely find a good shaman or shaman or someone who's going to make sure you have a good experience. And yeah, and definitely Google the risks and just be educated. Like, it's such a significant thing that it's worth doing the, you know, the reading and the just getting to know what you're getting into, really. You don't want to go into it and not know what it's going to be like. So
right. Yeah. And did you experience some of the things that I've heard about, like you instantly get sick right after you drink the tea? And
I didn't, but a lot of people did. And so I wanted to be sick, but I wasn't. I was just kind of retching, but nothing came out. I mean, I'd done this detox, you know, where I think it wasn't that I wasn't, it made me sick, but I had nothing to sick up, basically, you know. Yeah. So there was a funny thing. They had this toilet. So the building where we did it was like this kind of, it's hard to explain, but it was like a round building and there was like a concrete wall that came up about a meter high, and then there was a net around it. So you were kind of indoors and kind of outdoors, and there was a roof and everything, but then you were really kind of in the forest. And then outside they had this separate building, which was like a little toilet, like a little clay kind of toilet building. And the actual toilet was like raised up on this little thing. And I was like, wow, that's really weird. What's that all about? And then you realize that actually it's raised up because most people are using it to be sick into and not to use it for what you normally use it for. And so everybody gets a bucket and so on, and everybody is, lots of people are sick, but I think it's part of it. And obviously it's not great, but it's, nobody who I spoke to said that the being sick was like a problem, you know. And then also that the fact that it's a big open room, you know, like it's very well ventilated, so you could kind of think, oh, everyone's being sick, isn't everyone going to be sick because everyone's being sick? But it wasn't like that at all for us. There was, you know, there was a lot of air coming through, and I don't know whether there's someone coming and cleaning them up or not, but it definitely wasn't a problem. And so that's another thing definitely I should have said, is to be aware of that's going to happen. But and like I said as well, like a lot of people are crying, like because it's just so intense. So
right.
Yeah. And then but a lot of people have the hallucinations and kind of the visions and things like that, which is a more kind of psychedelic kind of what you imagine it's going to be like. So just do your reading and know what it is.
I'm also wondering, like you said that your experience was not hallucinations, and did you basically just sit there for 6 hours, or were you like kind of walking around, or what do most people do?
I wasn't walking around. So yeah, I was sitting there pretty much. And so you could go out and go to use the toilet or whatever and things like that. And so, but it was mostly sitting there or lying there. And there's obviously the music, which I mentioned. And so you kind of go in and out of the kind of deeper state, I guess you'd call it. And so the music really helped you get into this state where you feel like you're really appreciating everything. And I mean, physically, I guess you're just sat there and nothing's going on. But inside your head, everything is, you're kind of thinking, oh, this is, I understand this so much better than I did before. I understand that so much better than I did before. And then the kind of difficult bit is actually staying in that, the same as meditation, really. The difficult thing is like keeping that kind of focus and not getting distracted and thinking like, oh, I want to tell Jen that, you know, I just had this amazing thought, or I can't wait to put on Facebook that, you know, this happened or whatever. Seriously, those are the kind of things that you just get distracted by, and just, or like, just any thoughts that come up. And so, and that's a part of it. And then you kind of spend this whole time kind of coming in and out of this kind of deeper state. Yeah. So that's it. And then obviously it starts to wear off towards the end. And
sounds pretty amazing. I'm not sure I'm ready to sign up yet, but it's definitely something to think about. And it's mostly in, you can do it in Peru, I know. And is it in Mexico is a big place to go and do that?
Yeah, I don't know whether it's big, but it's definitely possible. So yeah, it's definitely possible. And the cool people that we did it with, they kind of tour around Mexico doing it. So they don't just stay in Playa. They were in Playa for this weekend that we were there.
Yeah.
And then they were moving on to somewhere else or whatever. We were very lucky. And you, like I was saying, you need to do the research. That's also because you need to find out that it's going to be possible and everything else. And I guess the other thing I'd recommend for preparation is doing meditation. Like, because you're sitting there on your own and having, not wanting to be distracted and so on, like having some like training, you've got to think of it as training for the mind. This is what he always calls it on Headspace. And so just, it's like doing jogging almost. Jogging trains your legs and meditation trains your mind. And if I wouldn't do it again, like next week, I would do it again. I don't know how long, but I would want to feel like my mind was ready for it. Not so much because your mind is going to suffer otherwise, but just in terms of kind of value for money and benefit that you're going to get out of it. The more kind of the higher level you are in terms of meditation type stuff.
Yeah.
Like, and that's kind of part of it, is that it, like, it feels in hindsight like it was like, it's like a super intense meditation, like 10 years worth of meditation into like one evening.
Yeah.
Kind of a thing. And so being ready meditation wise is, I would definitely recommend.
Yeah, that totally makes sense. Like your mind can probably handle it a little bit better if you've already been doing meditation every day or, you know, regularly.
Yeah, exactly. And just the things like the breathing and being aware of like thoughts coming. And I recommend Headspace a lot. Like it's so easy and convenient. The guy is really nice. Like he's really smart. He's not like a hippie kind of a guy.
Right.
He went and studied as a monk for years, but he talks a lot about the science of it, and it's all kind of backed up, and it's just very practical and very no nonsense. And some of it kind of could be kind of sound a bit wishy-washy, but it isn't. And it just all makes sense in the way he does it. And I recommend Headspace like to anyone. I'm definitely kind of an evangelist for Headspace now.
Yeah, I'm on it. I do it, you know, maybe 4 days a week. I'm meditating. I'm trying to make it a daily thing, but I have all these other things going on in the morning that sometimes get in the way. But I definitely see the benefits of it. It's a great way to go, and it kind of keeps you on track because it's sort of gamified where you want to get to the next level. You want to complete your sessions, and then you get to the next level. So that's kind of cool too.
Yeah, absolutely.
So then you guys left Mexico recently. And by the way, I read one of your blog posts on your thoughts on Mexico and how you kind of feel more what it's like to be British rather than, you know, really doing a deep analysis of the Mexican culture when you're when you're there. And the one thing I was laughing at is the noise levels that are in Mexico. And I experienced the same thing, and I decided that I couldn't ever live there because of that, because I was not used to that. It does not happen in the U.S. I mean, we like our quiet here, and they do not like quiet there. So I thought that was pretty funny.
Yeah, absolutely. The kind of stereotypical British kind of reserved and everything, all those kind of things. That's certainly true for me to an extent. And Mexico is just so the opposite of that.
Yeah.
And you really, for me, I feel very aware of it. And you feel very like closed, and like just because everyone is so open and friendly, and you feel a bit closed, but it's a good experience. And then to do it for 6 months, and I feel like, obviously there was the ayahuasca as well, but I feel like I'm a much more relaxed person having spent 6 months in Mexico. So
yeah, that'll happen. So then you decided to come up to America.
Yeah, well, so we're actually in America. We're on a visa run for Mexico. So like I said, we were on a bang on our 6 months. And so we wanted to stay in Mexico for Day of the Dead, which was last week. And so we were there for that. And then we've flown up. We've got friends in San Diego, which is obviously pretty close to Mexico, as pretty much as close as you can get. And so we decided to fly up and stay with them for a week, which is really great fun. And yeah, San Diego is great, and they're great. And it's a nice change. And then, but we're actually going back to Mexico next week. Up till the end of the year. So, yeah.
Cool. Yeah, we'll have to actually meet up here for a coffee or something before you
go. Sure.
not far away. It's not usual that I have guests on the show that actually are in the same area. So,
yeah, sure.
That's kind of nice. Do you ever feel like, because you guys have been traveling for a while now and going for these long periods, do you ever feel like at some point you're like, oh, I just want to settle down and stay somewhere?
Not really. So, I mean, we get asked this a fair bit. So, yeah, basically no is the short answer. But so you sometimes, there are definitely things that you miss. And so I miss my friends and I miss my family. And you occasionally get kind of homesickness. But the idea of just settling down somewhere at home or somewhere else, just at the moment, so I wouldn't never say never, but at the moment we have no plans to do that, and it's not something that we're thinking about or anything like that.
Okay, cool.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I guess this slow travel is kind of, it's quite a bit different than if you were constantly moving cities and having to reestablish yourself every month or so.
Yeah, I was going to say that. So, I mean, we tend to go for kind of 1 to 3 months, and we find it takes about a week to get really comfortably adjusted. And so things like knowing where you're going to work and stuff like that, all that kind of friction type stuff, that kind of gets smooth the longer you stay in a place. And so we kind of feel like 3 months is probably about, I mean, it depends from place to place, but 3 months in one place is about the amount of time where you kind of feel like you're comfortable and you know what the deal is and how to leave, to get on with, to be able to do what you want to do and not have any worries, but also and learn what you want to learn about the place and have the experiences. But then you're probably ready to go and start all over. And since we've been traveling, we've been getting slower and slower, really. So 6 months in Mexico, I don't know whether that's the longest time we've done in one country in one go, but we're certainly, our trend is definitely, you know, slower and more steady.
Where are you heading next? You said you're heading back to Mexico, Mexico City, or?
To Playa del Carmen.
Playa del Carmen, okay.
So we're going to go there for a month or so, and then we're heading to back to the UK for Christmas, and then maybe to, well, almost certainly to Thailand after that for a few months. And we kind of, we can't win really. If we book stuff in advance, then we always wind up changing our minds. But if you don't book stuff in advance, then it's more expensive when you're booking the last minute stuff. So
yeah.
At the moment, we tend to have plans, but not kind of concrete them until fairly close. And because, yeah, you just wind up paying to change plans as well. So
are you using airline miles, or are you paying out of pocket?
No, we're paying. So in the UK, as far as I know, we don't have the same opportunities with the airline miles that you guys get in the States, and so we're very jealous of that. So yeah, it's just cash money out of our pockets for the flights.
Yeah, it's unfortunate that your country wasn't built on credit cards like this one is.
Yeah, that's it. So yeah, those things always look amazing. It's an interesting system, but yeah, unfortunately we don't have it.
Yeah, it's good and bad. I mean, people get in insane debt here, but then if you know what you're doing, you can rack up points on airlines pretty quickly and without having to travel, which is really cool. But what's happened now is that so many people are doing this. So many people are just racking up the airline points that the airlines keep raising what it takes to get places. So it just gets harder and harder. So if you're not doing it, then you're really screwing yourself now. So I was going to say that you were saying the last minute thing. The advantage of points too is you can do last minute stuff and it doesn't cost you any more points. So if something is available, you can just jump on a flight like tomorrow or something, and it's not a big deal. But
yeah, I would love that.
Cool. Well, hey, Lewis, it's been really awesome having you on the show. It's been fascinating. I loved hearing your stories and the ayahuasca. And again, I'll give out your website. It's
itinerant dev. Itinerant. I've been surprised that this itinerant word has, I've had a few people from America who don't know what, haven't heard this word. And so it kind of means the same as like a traveler or just someone who moves around.
Oh, okay. Okay.
Yeah. So it's itinerant. So itinerant dev. So it's itinerant dev.com. I'm sure you'll put it in the show notes or something, but
yeah, I'll put it in the show notes for sure. Yeah, yeah, must be our Americans not really knowing English properly, right?
Oh, I don't think so. I think it's just I just happen to pick a word that is just more common in British English than it is in American English.
Okay.
But there you go.
Cool. Well, hey, thanks for coming on the show, and good luck with your travels, and we'll definitely be in touch.
Yeah, thanks ever so much. Fuente de alimento, tierra pura.
little Cebu.